हेलो एवरीवन, सुशांत
अच्छा, हाय सर। फर्स्ट माय इवनिंग स्टूडेंट्स, प्लीज गिव मी अ थम्स प्लीज गिव अस अ थम्स अप इफ ऑल ऑफ यू आर एबल टू हियर बोथ ऑफ अस।
परफेक्ट ना। सो यू आर एबल टू हियर अस, सी अस, एंड यू आर एबल टू सी दी स्लाइड्स एज वेल।
ट्रू,
ग्रेट ना, परफेक्ट। सो गाइस, आई एम डॉक्टर मुकुल, योर ऑर्थोपेडिक इंस्ट्रक्टर हियर एट अन अकेडमी, एंड माय पार्टनर इन क्राइम डॉक्टर सुशांत विल जस्ट क्विकली इंट्रोड्यूस हिमसेल्फ एंड वी विल गेट गोइंग।
हाय फ्रेंड्स, आई गेस यू ऑलरेडी नो मी। आई एम डॉक्टर सुशांत सोनी, एमबीबीएस मैम सी एमडी पैथोलॉजी रेजिडेंट हेमाटोलॉजी एम्स दिल्ली। सो इट्स अ प्लेजर टू हैव एन इंटीग्रेटेड ऑर्थो सेशन विद सर, विद मुकुल सर। सो सर, लेट अस स्टार्ट एंड लेट अस टेल द स्टूडेंट्स अबाउट आवर फर्स्ट क्वेश्चन।
Fine, guys. So I'll just be picking up from here. This session has been planned, especially keeping in mind the next pattern, okay, which will definitely require an integrated approach. What I mean by that, I'll just explain to you as I read out this question to you. So just quickly have a look. 6 years old girl, she's come to you. She's been having intermittent fever almost since a month. She could feel a palpable mass in somewhere in the middle of the thigh, and that's painful as well. The TLC counts are mildly raised, HB is a little low, and the ESI is raised as well. The X-ray seems to have been done. There's periosteal reaction, and there are areas of bone destruction. Okay. The biopsy picture, that's also shown over here, and that is the biopsy. You can have a quick look and the biopsy as well. Okay. So now what the examiner has actually asked you is regarding the prognosis. So which factor is going to indicate a bad prognosis? That's what the examiner has asked you. All right, guys. So I hope you can see a poll on your screen.
Please show the image, biopsy image again once.
Yeah. So I'll just show you the biopsy image. Have a quick look at the biopsy image, because that's what's going to give you the final diagnosis. Perfect. And meanwhile, in case you wish to have a look at the question, that is the question that I read in front of you. 6 years age, fever, palpable mass that is painful, counts little up. X-ray, periosteal reaction and destruction is there. And again, taking you to the biopsy image. So please take your pick, guys. The poll is right there in front of you. Perfect. So I have the poll results with me. Dr. Sushant, are you able to see the poll results?
No, sir, I cannot.
Okay, so I'll just indicate the results to you. 14% are here, 36% are here, and 36% are here, and 14% are here. So it's a very balanced kind of a result. Seems everyone is sitting together and attempting the polls.
Right, sir. So what yeah. we can... have a look is, I'll slightly interrupt. What we see here, friends, is that sir will be talking about the orthopedic approach to the question. But I, as a pathologist, am slightly biased, because the minute you have biopsy, sir, please show the second slide once. The minute you have biopsy, the clinical picture to me is immaterial, in the sense that with respect to a bone tumor, just one word, bone tumor showing me this. This bache is a monomorphic population of cells. All the cells, they have a round nucleus. Sir, please mark the round, the blue colored, all these are the nuclei. These are the nuclei which have a clear, well-defined cytoplasm. Cytoplasm has, it is well-defined and it is white in color. Why is it clear? Because of glycogen. So, sir, glycogen containing clear cytoplasm. So, these are the, this is this glycogen containing tumor is periodic acid shift positive, PAS positive, diagnosis Ewing sarcoma. So the first point with respect to this question was that it is a diagnosis of Ewing sarcoma, that is pathology. Now, before we come to prognostic markers, I'll hand over it to sir for further case discussion.
All right, guys. So as I call it an integrated question, I'll call it a truly integrated question. It is integrated from this aspect, that you have a ortho and a patho teacher solving the problem for you. But please understand the integration that next is going to give you. It's going to give you a question in a question format. So the first question you have over here, the diagnosis. You have to reach the correct diagnosis, because only if you reach the correct diagnosis, you go to step two, the prognostic factors. So that is the challenge that NEXT is going to pose to you. It's going to give you real integrated questions where you might have two or three parts in the question to solve. So how should you reach the diagnosis? Then you have to go through the integrated pattern and then decide the prognostic factors. A quick look. You've seen the... So what I do generally, whenever I see a patient, I categorize all the findings. So I'll start going through the question. Age, 6 years, fever. So I add fever over here. Go ahead. The counts are raised and there's a mass in the mid of thigh that is painful. Perfect. So I add over here, mid thigh is the location. Then there's a painful mass. Okay. Then TLC counts are mildly raised. All right. And then you have periosteal reaction with bone destruction. So these are the positive findings I've seen in the question. I always love to chart them down like this. It helps me to solve in no time. Now, just be very clear that you can only have four type of diagnosis. Either something could be congenital, or it could be traumatic, or it could be neoplastic, or it could be infective. Am I right, Dr. Sushant?
Totally, sir. Totally.
Nothing else exists.
Totally agree. So
now just see. There is a history of almost 1 month given in the question. Okay. And age is 6 years. So problem is only since 1 month. So congenital goes out. Remove it. There's no history of injury anywhere charted. No history of injury anywhere down the course. So traumatic gone out. So that straightaway limits me either to a neoplastic or an infective pathology. So that's where I start my work. It is either infective or neoplastic. So these are the differentials I'm left with. Now, once I decide the gross theme, infective and neoplastic, now I chart down the leads. So what puts things in infective? Age, fever, raised TLC count, and periosteal reaction. But what puts things under the chart of neoplastic? Age, most of the tumors, young age. And if it is neoplastic, I should be looking at malignant neoplasm, because it's just 1 month history. A benign tumor would not span up in a period of 1 month. Then fever can be there in some tumors. Pain, characteristic of some tumors. TLC can be raised in some tumors. And periosteal reaction can be there in some tumors. So both of the diagnoses are possible. So now next, I try to limit myself. What not? Well, if it is infection 1 month, it has to be chronic infection, chronic osteomyelitis. And the hallmark for chronic osteomyelitis would be sinus. There is nothing like sinus mentioned over here. So the possibility of infection goes down. But yes, everything in term of neoplasm is fitting it. And nothing is going against a neoplasm. So this now becomes my prime diagnosis. 4 years age, first decade, malignant neoplasm. Now, as far as malignant tumors are concerned, you can have osteosarcoma, a tumor from bone-forming cells. You can have chondrosarcoma, a tumor from cartilage-forming cells. You can have Ewing sarcoma, a tumor from marrow. And you can have a metastasis and multiple myeloma. Multiple myeloma and metastasis, old age. Chondrosarcoma, old age. So only two malignant tumors can be there in young age. It could either be osteosarcoma or it could be Ewing sarcoma. Now, here again, I will differentiate between the two, whether Ewing or osteosarcoma. A painful mass. Pain is clinching the diagnosis of Ewing's. Ewing is classically painful. Fever, TLC raised, Ewing's. Because Ewing's mimics infection known in osteopathics. Okay, periosteal reaction could be there in both. But look at this point, mid-thigh. Means the site is diaphysis. So when you talk of osteosarcoma, it is metaphyseal. But when you talk of Ewing's, it is diaphyseal. So three tick marks over Ewing's, going by the leads. So now my provisional diagnosis is evenings, but the final diagnosis is always biopsy. Doctor, please take
this. With respect to biopsy, there is absolutely no doubt about that fact. Please go one. Yeah.
This is the X-ray image, huge bone formation, periosteal reaction that you call as the onion peel appearance.
Mm-hmm.
Because if you cut this X-ray, you're going to find multiple layers of periosteal reaction. And how do they look like on the biopsy? This is the biopsy Dr. Sushant has already explained. So I'll just move forward and he'll just update you a little more on Ewing's sarcoma.
So Ewing's, it is the second most common malignancy in patients younger than 30 years of age. Next point, it is the most common age group, 5 to 25 years. Clinically, it's 5 to 25 years. Most common location is metaphysis with extension into diaphysis. Please note that it is a diaphyseal tumor, but the most common location is metaphysis, which extends into the diaphysis. Male predominant. Males are more commonly affected, not the females. And lastly, put a double star, translocation 1122, which this was last year's mains exam question. They had given you everything about Ewing's sarcoma translocation 1122, fusion transcript EWSR1, FLI1. The question that was asked was investigation of choice to detect this fusion transcript is FISH, fluorescent in situ hybridization. So this was Ewing's. Next point, coming to the poor prognostic markers in Ewing's, that was actually the question. Poor prognostic markers are distant metastasis, males, fever at presentation, anemia, increased ESR and late presentation of age. Now, out of these, the most significant poor prognostic marker is distant mets. Now, let us have a look at the question. In this, we'll keep this slide only, sir. So please keep that slide only. In the question, option three in prognostic factors, that is fever at presentation, was asked. So fever was the answer. Answer is not great because Ewing sarcoma is high grade tumor only. We do not talk of a low grade Ewing sarcoma. It is a high grade tumor. I guess, sir, some students confused grading with staging.
Staging, yes.
If stage would have been written, then distant metastasis or stage would have been the most significant.
This is a part of stage.
It is a part of staging. The option given was grading of the tumor and not staging. So the answer was three, that is fever. Answer was fever.
Yeah. So I hope you've got the message for the next exam. There'll be integrated questions where branches would be integrated. There'll be integrated questions where steps would be integrated. You make a diagnosis, then you reach the answer, prognostic factors. And there'll be questions where traps would be integrated into the question. Okay, so you have to read carefully, assess carefully. Fine. So I hope things are clear enough. I don't think there's any query.
Sir, I see sunrise appearance.
Okay, sunray appearance. We'll come to it. But I hope you're clear with this appearance we have shown in the X-ray, the onion peel appearance. What you find is periosteal reaction occurring in layers. So you find huge periosteal reaction like you can see over here. But when you're going to cut this mass, you give it to the pathologist will cut this mass, you will find the layers like you find in an onion. That is onion peel appearance, characteristic of Ewing sarcoma. And it's nothing else. Bone formation under the periosteum, periosteal reaction. Fine.
Just show the question once again, slide one. Maya Bachit, this is for you. Female, which is poor prognosis? Males was poor prognosis, not females. Recurrent fever episodes was poor. So the answer was B. It is not high grade, high stage. Increasing age was poor prognosis. So age less than 12 years is not. Maya, that was for you. Done, sir. Let's come to the second question.
Perfect, guys. So coming to the second question. All right. So I'll just read it again for you and underline the important points. 12 years boy, progressive swelling over left proximal arm. Notice this again, almost a month. Ill-defined margins, consistency, dilated veins can be seen crossing the swelling. Clincher. So I hope you can see multiple dilated veins going over the swelling. Proximal arm involved. Local temperature raised, but CRP is normal. Swelling is mildly tender. And again, you have a lamellated periosteal reaction with bone destruction. Biopsy is also shown. Oh, wonderful. Dr. Sushant has done a lot of homework for you. So he's shown you the biopsy again. Have a good look. Have a look at this material. I'm not a pathologist, but I know this.
Spotter. Actually, yeah. I mean, again, sir, but please come to the question again. Sure. As a pathologist, matlab, I will just, frankly, I'll just have a look at the first line. 12-year male with bone biopsy. Showing me this sort of a biopsy. So as sir gave us a huge hint, sir, please come to the biopsy. As sir even marked it, you have the presence of extracellular pink material in the bone that is osteoid. So this is an osteoid forming bone tumor. It is an osteoid forming bone tumor. Next point, the blue colored cells in the biopsy are the spindle cells. So it is an osteoid forming bone tumor with presence of spindle cells. Sufficient for me as a pathologist, osteosarcoma. So diagnosis, osteosarcoma.
Perfect. So let me just support what Sarah said from this question only. Okay. So as I always do, I never jump to a conclusion as a clinician, because for me, differentials hold the key. So I'll again chart down everything. 12 years is the age. Okay. Proximal arm. So that means metaphysis. Proximal arm would be metaphysis. Month history. So that is next thing I chart down. Okay. Dilated veins. The clincher, I call it. Okay. Because this is classical of osteosarcoma. Then you can see CRP is normal and local temperature is mildly raised. So here CRP normal means possibly no infection, and then a lamellated periosteal reaction and mild tenderness. Okay, mild tender, and again you have periosteal reaction. So when I chart them down, you know, again I go by the same approach: congenital, traumatic, neoplastic, or infective.
True.
So I take out congenital and traumatic. There is no trauma history. And then you have a history since a month in a 12 years boy. So congenital gone, trauma gone. I am left with neoplastic and infective. Infection gone because there is, the CRP is normal. So this also almost goes away. Okay. Infective things, TLC would generally be given. Fever history would be given. So no fever, no TLC high, no CRP high. So infective also gone. So this is neoplastic. 1 month history again tells me it is something malignant. So now I have just to choose which malignant tumor. So again, young age, I am caught up between osteosarcoma and I am caught up between Ewing sarcoma. Both can occur in this age group. Ewing's 5 to 15 years, classical age group. Osteosarcoma, bimodal age pattern, sir will just tell you. So now when I'm caught between two, how do I move ahead? Dilated veins, classically seen in osteosarcoma. Ewing's would be diaphyseal, metaphyseal site, again points towards osteosarcoma. In Ewing's, fever, raised TLC, CRP common, CRP normal, again points towards osteosarcoma. Mind you, the characteristic periosteal reaction that has been given, lamellated periosteal reaction, that is classical of Ewing's. But please understand, even in osteosarcoma, you can have periosteal reactions. What you can see over here is something called Codman's triangle. And what you can see over here is something called sun ray appearance. Please understand. Onion peel appearance, Codman's triangle, sun ray appearance. They are all periosteal reactions. They are because tumor lifts up the periosteum from the bone and there is bone formation under the periosteum. Please understand the reason. It is an innate response in the body that when you have a fracture, periosteum is lifted from the bone. And body just takes it as a fracture whenever periosteum is lifted from the bone, and body responds by new bone formation. That is the innate response. So all these tumors lead to new bone formation. Although Codman's triangle and sun ray appearance are classical of osteosarcoma, but all tumors, all malignant tumors can have either of the periosteal reactions. You can even find sun ray sometimes in Ewing's, and you can even find onion peel sometimes in osteosarcoma. And yes, a very important point, Ayushi, that you have raised, mildly tender. Please understand, sharp pain is a classical feature, clinical feature of Ewing's. and mild dull pain that continues is a classical feature of osteosarcoma, because what you have in osteosarcoma are micro infarctions because of tumor growth. These micro infarctions are responsible for the swelling being tender. Okay, and let me tell you, 25% of the people with osteosarcoma, they also have night pains. So these are some of the clinchers that go towards osteosarcoma. Rest, sir has just shown you the biopsy. He has shown you this osteoid formation, and he has shown you the spindle cells. So they would help you to clinch the diagnosis.
True.
Hope clear enough, guys?
Totally agreed, sir.
Sure. So your turn, sir. Please update them a bit about osteosarcoma.
So the microscopic diagnostic hallmark of osteosarcoma is osteoid production by malignant cells. So in the biopsy, that malignant cells that we saw was that the extracellular pink material was the osteoid. That was a clincher microscopically. Next point, it is the second most common primary malignant tumor. We will just make a list of the most common and we will go in that sequence. That will be our last slide for today. Next, sir, please put a star. This third point is extremely important. It is the most common radiation associated sarcoma. Very, very important, and it is pretty commonly asked. Next point,
most radio resistant and most radiation induced.
Induced. Totally agreed, sir. Totally agreed. Next, this involves the metaphysis. Less commonly, diaphysis and epiphysis are involved, but with respect to osteosarcoma, we classically say that it is a metaphyseal tumor. Clinically, it has a bimodal age distribution. It has bimodal means we have two peaks. The first peak is at 15 to 25 years of age, whereas this is the more common age group, 15 to 25, that is in adolescent or children. Second is at more than 50 years of age. This is osteosarcoma. The second peak occurs because of a pre-existing lesion. I guess we can show them type. There are three main pre-existing lesions. That is history of radiation to the bone, as we saw that osteosarcoma was the one which was associated, which was the most common radiation associated tumor. So history of radiation, Paget's disease, and an underlying bone infarction. So the lower three points, the second peak, in adults, it occurs because of an underlying predisposing condition, that is history of radiation, Paget's, or a bone infarction. This was osteosarcoma. Next, microscopically, we have the conventional intermedullary type. Next slide, we have the most presentation of the classical osteosarcoma, that is the conventional type, which can break the cortex and come as a soft tissue mass. I will show you the gross image of this. Conventional intermedullary type is most common. Next is the high grade surface type. This is the least common. So if I have to just remember one point with each, conventional intermedullary most common. Next, high grade surface is least common. Telangiectatic type is a lytic lesion. The name tells you, telangiectasia. It is a lytic lesion. That is, it has a ballooned appearance. Next is the secondary type. Last is the secondary type, which occurs in older individuals and are associated with predisposing conditions. So four main types of osteosarcoma: conventional, high-grade surface osteosarcoma, telangiectatic type, and the secondary type. Lastly, in this question, is it telangiectasic? Nahi bache. There was, sir, Ekba, please come back to the previous slide. What we see in telangiectasia is a aneurysmal bone cyst-like formation with a lot of hemorrhage. Here, hemorrhage is not there. You just have the presence of spindle-shaped cells with osteoid formation. So this was the conventional type. This was conventional intermedullary type. Next point. How do I know it is intermedullary conventional? Because of the associated gross. So next slide. Grossly, dekho, you have the whole medulla is replaced. Sir, can you please mark the medulla with extension into the cortex? What sir has highlighted with the blue color is the medullary involvement of osteosarcoma with extension into the, with which is breaking the cortex and it is going out as a soft tissue mass. This is osteosarcoma. Lastly, therapy.
Yeah, so treatment, I think, would be my part. So I'll just take over from Dr. Sushant here. So treatment, well, let me tell you, before I just take you through the treatment, osteosarcoma is one of the worst nightmare for the surgeon. A tumor that a surgeon never likes to see is osteosarcoma. Most chemo-resistant, most radio-resistant, most radiation-induced, and commonest to even metastasize. Goes to the lungs, generally by the hematogenous spread, and kills the patient. The five-year survival rates used to go down to the level of 20-25% only. So we used to have a very aggressive approach, amputation. We would straight away amputate these people. That was the story when the iPhones were not in the market. So things drastically changed over the past few years. So we had very good chemotherapy options that developed over the past few years, like the T10 protocol, a very aggressive chemotherapy protocol. So when good is this question, it's telogen type. No. In the question, it's conventional osteosarcoma, Yoshi. Okay. So conventional osteosarcoma, relatively less malignant, but telangiectatic type, very malignant. That's the worst nightmare for a doctor, as I've just told you. But now what has happened, that chemotherapy is now becoming more effective because we have very good options that are available. So now we have shifted our approach to something called a limb salvage surgery. So what exactly is limb salvage? I'll just put in a simple word to you. We start with a neoadjuvant chemo to decrease the size of the tumor. Then we go for a radical excision. Radical excision means we excise the whole compartment that has the tumor. So if there's a tumor in the femur, the commonest site, we excise the whole thigh. After this, we use a special prosthesis that is called megaprosthesis. And after megaprosthesis, we give the final shot of chemotherapy. So you have a double chemo, a chemo before neoadjuvant chemo to decrease the size, then radical excision, then a megaprosthesis, and then the final chemotherapy. Because you tend to have skip lesions. So this is a megaprosthesis that we use for limb salvage. I hope you can see it has a hip joint, it has a knee joint. That's one of the patients I've operated upon. So I've changed the entire femur. See, the hip joint is replaced, the knee joint is replaced. So when you replace the whole compartment, or you replace more than one joints, a prosthesis that has two joints is what is a megaprosthesis. So that is the surgery of the day. And almost survival rates up to 60%, five-year survival rates are now reported with this good chemotherapy protocols we have. So that's all about osteosarcoma. True. And just to finish up the story, the commonest tumor of the bone, guys, it's actually a metastasis. It's not a tumor of the bone. From other areas, tumors come to bone. So if you're asked the commonest primary tumor of the bone, that will actually become multiple myeloma. So someday we are going to trouble Dr. Sushant for this, because again, it's something that requires a combined approach.
True.
Starts from my side, from the marrow, but skips onto the kidneys. And orthopedic surgeons have a tunnel vision.
So we
keep it as the next project.
We will do it.
Yeah, so this is a malignant tumor from marrow, plasma cells. So if you're asked the commonest benign tumor, then the answer becomes osteochondroma, something that you call as the exostosis. Okay, but there's a big query on exostosis. Some people say that it's a tumor-like lesion, an aberration of growth plate. Some people say it's a true tumor. So sometimes examiner uses this word true benign tumor. And then the answer becomes osteoid osteoma. And yes, if you're simply asked the commonest lesion of the bone, the answer becomes fibrous cortical defect, a part of cortex of bone replaced by fibrous tissue. That is fibrous cortical defect. And mind you guys, when I use the word lesion, it simply means no pleomorphic nuclei, nuclear ATPR and all those kind of things. Dr. Sushant knows the features of malignant lesions. And no metastasis from the clinical side. No other bone involved, no other organ involved. So then you use the word lesion. But with all other tumors, there is growth. Other bones can be involved. They can become malignant on rare times. That is how you differentiate a lesion from a tumor. That's all from my side.
Done.
You can just quit them. Bye-bye.
So absolutely a pleasure. And we will have, Sir Ashmita has a doubt. Isn't fracture the commonest?
No, fracture is not called a lesion. Okay, please understand. fractures come under a category in orthopedics called traumatology. Okay. The word trauma is an English word that means wound. So study of wounds was traumatology. A wound has nothing to do with the tumor. All right. So fractures are absolutely a separate field. Lesion means mass, or lesions means you see a defect in the bone. It has nothing to do with the fracture. That will be absolutely a separate field related to injury. Fine, Ashwita?
Totally.
Any other queries, guys?
So I guess, sir, we can wrap up at this.
Let them know about the iconic subscription that has been introduced. Most common metastasis into the bone. Well, generally, breast is taken to be the commonest source of metastasis into the bone, Ayushi, overall. But in the males, it is the prostate. Okay. Otherwise, the area that generally gets involved is the spine by these metastasis in orthopedics. So let me just quickly introduce you to the iconic subscription. Here you can subscribe for Unacademy and Prep Ladder at a very, very special discount price. Just check up the app for the details. And this is the subscription price. So if you take an year subscription, this is all you pay for both Unacademy as well as Prep Ladder subscription. So the integrated approach has been expanded even to give you the subscription, both Prep Ladder and Unacademy in a combined manner.
And we'll be having numerous such integrated sessions, and a pleasure to interact with everybody. Guys, have a well-deserved dinner at this point. You too, sir. Take care and thanks for joining.
Yeah, Tej, most common malignant tumor of the hand. Well, let me tell you, if you have a tumor in the hand, at least at your level, it is going to be enchondroma unless proven otherwise. Okay. And the malignant version of the enchondroma, okay, that will be chondrosarcoma. That will be the commonest malignant bone tumor of the hand. Okay. If you exclude the bone tumor, because your question is commonest malignant tumor, I think it would be squamous cell carcinoma overall. Okay. But from bone side, enchondroma or chondrosarcoma would be the commonest tumor in the hand. Fine. All right, guys. So hope you enjoyed.
Thank you. To you, sir. Take care. Take care. Okay. Good.